secretary, principal, head of the department, students of Sarnathan College of Engineering, Tiruchirappalli. I extend a warm welcome to one and all present here. At the outset, I would like to express my sincere thanks to Athella Academy for supporting us magnanimously for the conduction of such an online program in this pandemic situation. May I now request our beloved professor, Dr. M. Batma, to introduce Professor Dr. Babdullah to all the participants present here. Please, madam, over to you.
Thank you, sir. So I am very much delighted to introduce our speaker, Dr. Vakula madam. She is working as associate professor in Department of Electronics and Communication Engineering, National Institute of Technology, Warangal. Her field of interest are antenna arrays, multifunctional array, ultra wideband antennas, fault diagnosis of antenna arrays, artificial neural networks. She did her ME in microwave engineering and research in fault diagnosis of antenna arrays. She has more than 20 publications in various referred international journals and more than 50 articles. She has published more than 30 articles in international conferences. And she has received more than rupees 75 lakhs from various funding agencies like DLRL, CARS, DRDL, etc. for research work as a principal investigator. Some samples are, she is working as a principal investigator CARS project, a characterization of dual polarized waveguide slot radiator for an amount of rupees with RCA Hyderabad. And these are her only samples. She has and another project, principal investigator car of wideband array for missile applications for an amount of rupees 18.6 lakhs for 12 months. And she guided many research scholars, and two of her research scholars awarded PhD degree. And also she guided more number of UG students as well as PG students in different domains. She is such a dynamic personality. She is very friendly with students, and she has won best paper award in presenting one paper in international conference. I welcome you, ma'am. We are eagerly for receiving mind-blowing lecture from you, ma'am. Thank you. I handed over the session to Dr. Vakula madam.
Thank you, madam, for the introduction given by you. Good morning to all the participants and the organizers and the committee administration of the Sarnathan College of Engineering, Tiruchirappalli. I will start the session. And one question, shall I share my PPTs?
Yes,
ma'am. Yes, I will share my PPTs. If you give the permission.
Madam. Yes, madam.
Yeah. Yeah, can you see the screen?
Yes, madam, it is viewed.
Yeah, okay. I have switched off my video also. Yeah. Now, is it visible in the slideshare mode?
Yes, ma'am.
And how is my voice? Is it audible?
Your voice is audible. And the screen is visible, madam.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah. Good morning to all the participants of the AICT sponsored Atal Academy FTP on cognitive radio antennas and millimeter wave communications. And I also thank the organizers for this FTP and giving me an opportunity to give a lecture in this session on massive MIMO devices and circuits. Okay. So I hope all the participants have enjoyed the previous sessions on cognitive radio and antennas radiation and the coming topics on millimeter wave communication also. Okay. Now my topic is on MIMO. Actually, all these whatever the sessions you are having in this FTP, all of them are interrelated. Like maybe there may be some overlaps of my talk with some other resource person's talk also, because there is a link between all the millimeter wave communication, MIMO, and antennas and antenna arrays. So there may be some overlaps are here and there, but okay. I will try to focus mostly on the MIMO devices, massive MIMO, and the circuits. Okay. So before actually going into the details of this MIMO, just I want to give a few like an introduction to the MIMO systems or MIMO devices or MIMO antennas. Okay. And one more thing, what I can say is MIMO is very much related to the 5G communications. So which is the next generation communications. And this is a sample picture of the MIMO. Okay. So because we are telling communication, just I want to say a few words regarding the communication. Okay. So before going into the MIMO, let us just have a few introduction about the communication. So a communication, generally, what is a communication? Just a basic explanation. Like I am talking with a person who is sitting beside me. I am communicating with him. I am speaking, the other person is listening. So mine is a sound wave. So I am going to talk with him or her, the other person who is beside me. I am speaking and my sound signal is traveling through the air, free space. And the other person is listening. So what we can call is whatever the communication I am performing with the other person is like a wireless communication. So only the medium is the free space. So through free space, I'm communicating. Okay. So that is a wireless communication. Even though I'm not generating an RF or electromagnetic signal, but I'm generating a sound signal. The other person is also receiving a sound signal. So this is like an example for a wireless communication. Maybe it's not a radiation, but it's a sound. Okay. Maybe the way the sound is propagating is different from the way the electromagnetic wave propagates in the medium. Now, if the other person is not here beside me, he's at a different place, still I want to communicate. So how we can have the communication, like the voice communications or the audio communications, how we can have the communications? So for that purpose, the telephone is developed. So in a telephone, far communication, we are sending the voice to longer distances. So what is done, whatever the speech, whatever the talk, whatever the time speaking is converted to electrical and it is sent through a cable. And that cable will be sent to the telephone exchange. From the telephone exchange, if I request to connect to a particular person, the telephone exchange is going to do the connection. So I'm going to still communicate with the other person who is at a very far distance with the help of the cable through the telephone exchange. So the telephone, it's like a wired communication. Still I'm communicating with the same person, but it's a wired communication. So because I am sending my voice through a wire, through a cable, and the form of the signal on the cable is also electrical signal. It's not an electromagnetic wave. So electric E and H are there, but always, but mostly we'll say it's an electrical signal. So here you are having the telephones. So where two people can communicate through lines, through cables, and the exchange, telephone exchange is going to become a center. At the center, so all the users will be connected to the telephone exchange to the cables. Okay. So this is how actually we were communicating. Communicating means we were talking with other people's friends or relatives or anyone with the help of the wide networks. Then instead of going for the in that case, we have the telephone exchange, we have the users, all the telephone, all the users are connected to the telephone exchange through the cables. Now there we have to lay the cables from the user to home to the exchange, and then we have to do the communication. But why shouldn't we remove the wire and become wireless? Okay. Why shouldn't we go for the wireless means instead of going for the wired means? So there are many advantages what we are using, what the benefits are we are utilizing, we are seeing, and we are enjoying all the benefits of becoming wireless, removing the line from the home to the telephone exchange. So we converted into a wireless system. So in the wireless communication, the user, he can sit in the home or he can be anywhere, he's still going to communicate with other user through the telephone exchange. So remove the cable, becoming wireless. So what is becoming wireless means, what is that we have to do? We have to transmit our voice to an electromagnetic field. Okay. And then we have to transmit towards the telephone exchange. And the telephone exchange again transmits it back to the other user, whoever we are requesting for. So there between the house or between the user and the telephone exchange, there is a wireless communication. The telephone exchange, now we are going to call it as a base station. So in the base station and the users are communicating through the wireless medium by transmitting the electromagnetic waves from both sides, here to there and there to here. So you want to radiate, base station wants to receive. Base station will radiate, you have to receive. So a device which converts the electrical to electromagnetics, or which converts electromagnetic to electrical, is an antenna. So once you have removed the wire in the telephone communications, you need a device, an antenna, which is going to transmit the voice to electromagnetic wave, the base station, which can redirect or retransmit towards the other user, again in the form of an electromagnetic wave. And similarly, the user has to receive the electromagnetic wave and convert it to voice in intermediate. So here for this wireless means, we need an antenna both at the user, which is a transmitter and receiver, and we need antennas at the base stations, which are also transmitters and receivers. So now the wire has become the wireless. Okay. So here in this process, once we have become wireless, okay, we have become wireless. So we don't have to sit at the home in a particular room connected to a particular corner of the room. We can become mobile. The user have become mobile. So it's a mobile device. So whatever the telephone we are using has become the wired to a mobile device. So we are using, carrying a mobile device, the user, we. We can sit in this room or that room, or we can be anywhere, not only in the house, we can be anywhere in the particular place. So whatever the users, what we are having, they have become mobile, they are carrying a mobile device. So this wireless is also have converted to a mobile communication, because the user is a mobile, he is not fixed. Previously he is fixed, but now he is not fixed. He has become mobile, he has the mobility. So it has converted into a mobile communication then later. So now later, because we are speaking of that wire and wireless, and that we have come to the wireless now. Now let us just speak something regarding that device which will convert the electrical to electromagnetic wave, both at the mobile unit and both at the base station. Okay. So let us assume you have the, you can see my cursor, I think this is the a transmitter, assume that the base station. So here you have a antenna which has to radiate. So initially, what type of antennas are there? We are going to have an antenna. It is a wireless device. But initially, like we are having this wireless communication initially only for the broadcasting purpose. What is the broadcasting that wireless communication initially used for? We have the radio, FM, AM, and different waves, short waves. And we are also having that TV transmission. So initially, that wireless communication is only for the broadcasting purpose, not for the telephone conversation. So once initially where it was used for the broadcasting purpose, what type of a broadcaster is required here? Users can be anywhere, radio or TV. So what type of antenna we need at the base station? Like if it is a broadcasting, it has to broadcast in all directions. Here we are going to place the antennas which will radiate uniformly in all directions. So the antennas which are placed on those broadcast stations or broadcast transmitters are omnidirectional radiators. And we have the omnidirectional radiators, the basic antennas or the dipoles and the monopoles. Dipole is an omnidirectional radiator. Similarly, the monopole is also an omnidirectional radiator. They are going to radiate uniformly in all the directions because the radio users can be anywhere, not in a particular directions. There will be in all around, surrounding that that station, broadcasting station or the transmitter. So we are going to use a monopole and a dipole antennas, which are basically omnidirectional radiators. So even the FM radio or the TV transmission, they are going to use omnidirectional radiation, where the radiation is uniform in all the directions. So the type of antenna we have to use at the base station, maybe for us also, it must be an omnidirectional radiator. It has to radiate uniformly in all the directions. That's the first requirement. Now, what about the radio? Radio is also a mobile device. So we can keep the radio anywhere. We used to carry the radio. Even the mobile phone, whatever we are holding, is also a mobile device. It's not fixed. So what type of antenna we need at the mobile device? It must also be of a omnidirectional receiver or omnidirectional radiator. One way means it will receive, two ways means it has to transmit, it has to receive also. So on the mobile phone also we need a antenna which is an omnidirectional receiver or omnidirectional. Hello. Okay. Yeah, okay, wait. I'm in the first layer one. I will change after 2 minutes. So just 1 minute, because in the introduction slides, I did not put those basic slides. So that's why I'm in the first slide. So after this, coming to this, I will change. Yeah. So here, because now those are the basic things now. So that's why I did not prepare the slides for this. So here, you are going to have an omnidirectional radiator, omnidirectional antenna, both at the base station and both at the cell phone also or the mobile phone. Okay, that's a basic requirement. So if you're going to design an antenna for the base station, we have to design an antenna which is omnidirectional because it has to transmit uniformly in all the directions. Similarly, if it has to receive the mobile unit, it must also be a omnidirectional receiver. That is a second point. And the third thing is, suppose you are going to have a fixed, because if you speak of the TV reception, what type of antenna you are using for the TV? TV transmission will be omnidirectional, but what about the TV receiver? Is it directional? Because we know where the station is present, transmitted from the transmitter, we are going to receive in a particular direction. So the TV receiver, either the Yagi antenna or the dish antenna or the directional antennas, because they are fixed, they know the actual where the transmitter is, they can point it directly to the transmitter. Now, one point I can say, what about the directional and omnidirectional is, like why we go for the directional instead of the omnidirectional? What is the main advantage here if you go for the directional instead of omnidirectional? In omnidirectional radiator, it is going to radiate the power, whatever the input we are giving, uniformly in all the directions. Whereas the directional, it is going to receive, radiate everything in a particular direction. So directional antenna will have more gain compared with the omnidirectional antenna. So that's why wherever it is possible, if you want to increase the gain, we'll go for the directional. wherever you need the requirement of transmitting in all the directions, you are going for the omnidirectional radiator. So that's the first thing. What type of radiators we need for the antenna? What type of antennas we need for the base station, and what type of antenna we need for the cell mobile unit? Next, let us here come here. So we have the base station, which is a radiator. Now we said that we have removed the wire through wireless. Okay. Now all the mobile units can communicate with this base station, and they can communicate between each other with the help of the base station. But what is the limitation there? Like audio, we want to send a particular bandwidth, maybe 4 kilohertz or something. We want to send some voice signal. So depending upon the frequency allotted to the base station, you can accommodate so many users for that particular frequency range. So maybe 100 or 1000, like that 10,000. But you cannot go above that if you want to increase the number of users. So now the breakthrough or the main advances or have started coming with the replacing the base station or replicating the base station and mobile users. So what is done here? You are going to use a particular frequency. Okay. Here, this is the base station, and you have the users, different users. So here, if a base station is transmitting a particular frequency, so it can accommodate n number of users depending upon the bandwidth available to this. So instead of limiting the number of users, what is done is the same frequency is used at different places. Like the once the concept of frequency reuse has come, the entire area is divided into cells. Okay. So where you have the base station, where you will have the users. So this is again replicated everywhere. So the entire area is divided into cells. So which is called as a cellular network. So the major development which has come in the communication used to the mobile communication, and then the next one is the dividing the area into cells, and in each cell we are going to use the we can use the same frequency because spectrum is limited. We can use the same frequency. So this is the main advantage, main breakthrough in the communications. So the cellular networks. So these cellular networks have started the generations from 1, 2, 3, 4, 5G, like that. Different generations have come where we are not only sending the voice, we are texting, we are video. We also want to get connected through the internet also, where we can download the information and we can also upload the other information also. So this one advantage of this communication is the concept of the cellular networks, where the entire area is divided into cells, where you have the one base station for each cell, different n number of users will be there in the cell. So like this, and in each cell you can use the same frequency. So as the number of cells are increased, the number of users will be multiplied by the same time, 2 cells into 2, 3, like this. The capacity is because has increased to many extent. So the first one is a geographical dividing the area into cells is the first thing. So once the we are getting more advantage, we want to get more and more. The greed has increased. Like we not only that we don't want to just divide this area into increase the number of users, we also want to increase the capacity. So that now we want to increase the capacity means not only voice, we want to send a video, we want to download movies, we want to upload our videos, everything we want to do. So we have the more urge, like we want to send more and more speeds, like high download speeds and high upload speeds, which can go up to 10 gigabits per second. And we also want to get connected directly always to the internet and the YouTube, whatever it is. So the need is becoming more and more. So basic division of the cellular division of the areas into different cells and increasing the capacity is not the end there. Still more and more developments have done, like that the 5G communication has come into effect. 5G and beyond, 4G, 5G and beyond 5G, 6G also. So all are proposed. So in whatever, what is that we want to do within the all these systems, we want to increase the bandwidth. The first one is we want to increase the spectrum or the bandwidth. If you want to increase the bandwidth, what is that we have the a limited bandwidth. We want to go up to the other frequencies also so that we can accommodate more number of users, we can accommodate more number of facilities also. This is the first thing. And the other thing is we also want to reduce the cells. So densifying the cells to achieve the required area throughput. So we want to send more number of bits per second, per hertz. By using this, dividing the cells. Like we were in a rural area, we can have a bigger area. In urban areas where the number of users are more, we are going to reduce the cell size. Like macro, micro, pico, femto, and different cells. We are going to reduce the cell size as much as possible, by which you can accommodate more number of users and more throughput we can achieve. And one more thing is the spectral efficiency. Not only increasing the bandwidth, we also want to use the spectrum effectively so that we can send more number of bits. Efficient use of the spectrum. So the same spectrum, we don't want to waste any spectrum because spectrum is limited. That's the other point. So to have all these things, we want very good throughput. Use the spectrum effectively and provide as much bandwidth as possible. These are the things what we want to increase the capacity. So different capacity enhancement techniques are proposed. Some are from the signal point of view, some are from the architecture point of view, some are from the antenna point of view. So in all the different ways by which we can improve the throughput. So different methods are proposed for the 5G and for the coming systems also. So where we can increase the capacity. Like, because this is a MIMO system, so one technique by which we can have the increase the capacity is the MIMO devices. We are going to increase the number of antennas. And we also want to, from the antenna point of view, we want to have a better designs, compact, high gain, and large wideband antennas in for this capacity enhancement. And here we also going for this case, we also use that antennas for better spatial multiplexing. We want to form the beam forming, switch beams also we want to apply. So these are the different ways by which we can have this antenna point of view. And from the cell point of view, we want to densify the networks and we want to sectorize the cell also. And from the signal point of view, we want to go for the modulation and coding scheme, the networks point of view, multi-rat networks and relay nodes, and new air interface and multiple access techniques. We also want to have the different access using the base station by multiple users parallelly. And we also want to increase the spectrum. So these are the different ways which are proposed to enhance the capacity of the system of the 5G, 6G, and 4G also. And other techniques are like we can also use for the other communications like visible light communications. You can go for the spectrum for millimeter waves and terahertz. These are the by which we can increase the bandwidth of the system. And you can also use the beam forming by which we can increase the capacity of the system, small cells and full duplex system. So these are the ways by which the capacity or the throughput can be increased. Capacity means by which we can increase the throughput of the system, 5G systems, 4G systems, or 6G system, any system. The first one of the point what we have mentioned is regarding the spectrum. We want to increase the spectrum. Like to how much extent we want to increase, like because increase. How much extent? So previously it is from 3 to 30 gigahertz is the micro frequency range, which is used for the RF communications, terrestrial communications. And because we want to have the more and more, so we can also have the explore the other frequency ranges, which is from 30 to 300 gigahertz is the millimeter wave range. So for the 5G, some bands are given in the micro range, some bands are also given in the millimeter, 28 gigahertz in the millimeter wave range also. So if you're going to increase the higher, going for the higher frequencies, bandwidth is more, we can accommodate more users and we can have the more bit rate also. And above the millimeter wave is also have, we have the terahertz wave. So this is 5G is millimeter. If you go for 6G, you are going for the terahertz, more data. Okay, so this terahertz is going from 300 gigahertz to 3 terahertz. So this is the spectrum what we are going to use, the micro range, millimeter wave range, and terahertz range. So 5G is from here to here, in the some in the microwave and some in the millimeter. 6G, you are going for the terahertz waves. So you can see you are going to increase the bandwidth. You are going to increase the frequency. You can accommodate more and more bandwidth. And you can also increase the data rates. So these are the different frequencies what we can propose. And we mentioned that we have the multiple, we can also go for the multiple access, novel multiple access strategies, massive MIMO, beamforming, and antenna designs. These are the points what we are going to discuss in our in my presentation. One multiple access techniques, what is a massive MIMO forming, and some of the antennas which are used for the 5G communications. So MIMO and then massive MIMO. A massive MIMO is proposed for the 5G systems. So in a massive MIMO, the first point is in the mobile communications or cellular communications, what is that we have? We have the base station and we have the users. This is the first point. Okay. So all the users have to connect to the base station within that cell, within that area, whatever the area we have. Okay. So this is the base station. These are the users. So they have to get connected to the base station. So they want to transmit or they want to receive, it must be done only through the base station, to the base station. So in a MIMO, before going to the MIMO, just one point. In a massive MIMO is, we are going to have more number of transmitting and receiving antennas. So that's why you're going to call it as a massive MIMO. Massive MIMO is proposed for the 5G and the next future communications also. So the brief definition of the massive MIMO is, it have more number of elements, antenna elements at the base station. We are speaking about the base station antennas, not the users. So base station has more number of antennas. So if more antennas there, we have the more focused energy, less interference, more spatial multiplex layers, very good throughput and coverage, larger number of users who are served simultaneously. Introduce, we can also introduce two-dimensional beamforming. So two-dimensional beamforming means we can have a beam which is formed like a fan. So these are some of the advantages of the massive MIMO. So this massive MIMO is proposed for the 5G communications. And the next point is the beamforming. What is this beam forming and what is that we want to do in the beam form? So here, as we mentioned, that the base station is going to have a omnidirectional antenna. It has an omnidirectional antenna. You have the users here. So it is going to radiate. The users are going to receive in all the directions. So whatever the frequency or whatever the power it has, the frequency it will transmit to all the users and the power will be distributed uniformly. So it is going to receive. This is a conventional thing. Now you are going for the beam forming. In a beam forming, what is that you are going to do? Instead of transmitting the same in all the directions, you can also focus the entire energy in a particular direction. You can use the same frequency. You can also use a different frequency. One this side, other this side. So here, by using this type of beam forming, we are able to focus the energy in a particular direction more compared with other directions. So if a user is present here, there is no user here. You don't have to transmit in this direction. You want to only transmit to this user. So this information need not go to the user two, user A. So in those cases, you can concentrate the energy in a particular direction. So by using the technique called as the beam forming, either to A, B, C. So this is the advantage of beam forming in a MIMO system, in a massive MIMO system. You are going to take the advantage of the beam forming. How? When you can form a beam? Beam can be formed if there are more number of elements, that array. So we are going to use large number of elements to take the advantage of beam forming in the massive MIMO. Next, coming to the antenna design. Okay. So what is that antenna? Here you have a transmitting antenna. Here you have a receiving antenna. The transmitter is transmitting, receiver is receiving. So once the transmitter is transmitting, how the transmitter transmits? Will it transmit in a line or it will transmit over a range, over an area? We don't have the transmitters like very focused transmissions, not like a laser. It will transmit over a particular beam width area. So once it is transmitting over a beam width, so signal is covered in this range. So it is going to transmit in this range, in this area, beam width. So what happens? These are aligned in the maximum direction. So whatever is the maximum value is going here. But here some of the RF energy is also going this side. So it can get scattered and come this direction. If there are reflections, it can come this direction. If there is any one more transmission, one more multiple reflections, or if there is any bending. So this receiver, because all are of the same frequency, they're traveling this much area. So if they're traveling this much area, the receiver will also receive all those signals which are traveled here through multiple reflections scattering. And because they're of the same frequency or different frequency, it will receive. So what happens? You have the signals which are going to travel through the multipaths. The transmitter is transmitting and the receiver is going to receive the signals which are traveling in different directions. So what happens? This will come at T. This will 1 second, 2 seconds, 3 seconds, 4 seconds, 5 seconds of different times and different amplitudes. So what is you are going to have here is the fading effect. So if fading is going to occur at the receiving antenna due to the multiple path propagation of the signal. So this is also taken as an advantage. This is happening. So which is a drawback here? Fading effect is occurring here at the receiving antenna. This is not an advantage. To explore this fading effect, to take this as an advantage. So instead of going for a single antenna, multiple antennas are also proposed, basic this. And the signals will be combined and subtracted. So you have to design the, study those things in the MIMO system. Now, because we are saying that capacity enhancement, throughput is also increased, and we also need more and more data speeds. So that we have the faster mobile. Still now, our mobile phones, whatever we are using, we are not even today also satisfied with the speed, whatever we are receiving. We are not satisfied with the download speed of our internet. We want more and more speed, more faster downloads. Previously, there were no movies, no videos, then there is no problem. Once it is coming, we want at a more speed. Nothing is okay, but coming means we want even at a more speed. So faster mobile broadband speeds. Extensive mobile data usage, continuously we want to use. And the full potential of Internet of Things from the virtual reality. So not only this, we also want to control remotely. We want to switch on, switch off all the gadgets at home from office or from office to home and control everything virtually. And we want to have no driving, just sit in the car. And smart cities, everything is connected. So this is the reason, because my applications are many for this 5G or 6G. People are ready to use it. So once it is launched, everybody is eager. Because more and more facilities, more and more requirements are there, and more you want to use it. So for this, what are the different ways by which we can increase the capacity, throughput of the system? All the ways we can explore and we can do. Because as I mentioned in the diagram, many possibilities are there. We can, from the signal point of view, from the network point of view, from the antenna point of view. Three maybe broadly I can categorize into. So sir, from the signal point of view, the communication side, from the antenna point of view, RF engineering, from the network's point of view. And many things we can have the explore. So one such type of is the MIMO system, massive MIMO, MIMO, multiple input, multiple output system. So this multiple input, multiple output is relating to the that antenna part. So where we are not using the single transmitter and single receiver, Because no, we know that we have seen that in the single transmitter and single receiver, even though we are placing single transmitter and single receiver, the signal is not going in one direction, it is traveling in multiple directions. So by which we want to use that multipath propagation also as an advantage. How? By placing multiple transmitters and multiple receivers. So here we are going to have more number of inputs, transmitting antennas, more number of receiving antennas. So by which, and we also want to exploit that multipath propagation and then get a better system. And one more is multiple axis also. We can also use the antennas for the different multiple axis techniques. The basic multiple axis is, we said that we have the base station, we have the users, okay? And the users have to definitely communicate with the base station. No two users can communicate between each other. They have to get connected to the base station only. Only base station will redirect the information. So one base station is there, multiple users are there. So you want to access, means all the users cannot access the base station at the same time. So we are going to have the multiple access techniques, different access techniques, like FDMA, different frequencies, TDMA, CDMA, and spatial multiplexing, multiple access is also there, which we can provide with the antennas. These are with respect to the signal, we can have the spatial multiple access with the help of the antenna systems, spatial. And the antennas, whatever we are designing, we have to design for this MIMO systems or for the 5G or for the 6G, whatever the antennas we have. There are many challenges in designing this antenna. The first one is they must be of the higher frequency, either the microwave or the millimeter or even the terahertz also. Bandwidth, so higher frequency and more the bandwidth. We also need a better bandwidth also, because designing at the higher frequency with large bandwidth is also not so easy. And low profile and efficient antennas, lesser cost and easily integrable with the circuits, and efficient antennas, efficiency also must be good. And you want higher gain so that you can reduce the input given to the antenna, and increased power radiated, that means the power handling capacity of the antenna also must be large. And antenna arrays, not only single element, we also want the antennas to be in the form of arrays. And we have the beam forming, making the radiation in a particular direction, and beam steering, rotating the beam in any direction. And sometimes you also want to multiple beams. So these are the challenges. These are the different ways by which we can increase the throughput. And these are the different challenges we have to face while designing the antennas in the MIMO system. So let us just see here, in the MIMO system. We'll see few examples for the MIMO antennas. You have the traditional ones or the single transmitter and single receiving antenna, which we call it as a single input and single output, SIS1. So you have the transmitter and you have the receiver, single input and single output. Now you have because we said that we are not receiving the signal in one direction, we can also receive in multiple directions. Okay. So instead of placing one antenna and receiving all the signals in different paths, why shouldn't we place multiple antennas and receive the signals from different directions? Okay. The user is same, but we want to receive the signals which are coming in the other directions also. And we want to combine the signals at the user, which are traveling at different directions, and put it more efficiently. Either we want to increase the SNR or we want to increase the throughput, we want to use this multiple antennas at the receiver, because we are receiving the signal from through multiple paths, multipath propagation. So this. For this purpose, we can also go for the multiple antennas at the receiver, receive diversity. Okay. And then add them or combine them or see them, what is the best way you can collect all the three signals, combine them and get the better. Or you can also use multiple transmitting antennas and give it to the single output. In the multiple transmitting antennas, we can send the same information at the same time, or we can delay them, or we can modify them, by which we are going to have a better system. So here we can also place the multiple antennas at the transmitter, and then receiver can be one. So here the transmitter is the base station, receiver is the user. So we also want to place the multiple antennas here, as many number of antennas as possible at the base station. But user doesn't require so many antennas, maybe one or two, or even one is also sufficient most of the times. So then comes the both the transmit diversity and receiver diversity. We want to have multiple antennas at the transmitter and multiple antennas at the receivers also, which is going to be the multiple input, multiple output system, MIMO. Multiple input and multiple output, transmit and receiver antennas. So this is also transmitting, this is also receiving. So here the communication of the user to the base station will be the uplink, and the communication of the base station to the user will be the downlink. So both for the uplink and downlink, we are using the multiple antennas, but base station you place more number of antennas. Okay. So here you have the transmitter with multiple antennas, you have the receiver with multiple antennas. Now we say that the transmitter is transmitting maybe the same or maybe different. No, not required. It has to send the same. It can transmit same or can transmit some delay or with a different coding. And receiver is receiving. So here the channel is going to play a role. So the channel is going to give multiplied by some weights. So these are the weights H. The channel matrix. So you are going to receive the signals with the help of the channel matrix, determined channel matrix. You can estimate what is the signal you have received here through the multiple receivers and perform some algorithms and extract the information. So initially, like a MIMO system is usually referred as multiple antennas at the transmitter and multiple antennas at the receiver. But nowadays, MIMO refers to a practical technique for sending and receiving more than one data signal simultaneously. It's not that you are sending one data signal through multiple antennas and multiple receiver. We also want to send more than one data signal simultaneously over the same radio channel by exploiting the multipath propagation. So it's not that we are sending the same through all the antennas and receiving the same. So we can also send multiple data, more than one data signal also. And MIMO is fundamentally different from the smart antenna techniques developed to enhance the performance of single data signals such as beamforming and diversity. So let us just speak something regarding the MIMO antenna and antenna array. In a MIMO antenna, you have the multiple antennas. So, but these multiple antennas need not be placed like an array. And all the antennas are going to be individual antennas only. They are going to receive like individual antennas. Whereas in array, you are going to place them with some spacing, uniform spacing, and you are going to combine the information, received signal, and add up all the informations. So in the MIMO, we are going to provide some algorithms, but in the array, we are going to add up all the signals. So array is different from MIMO antenna. Array function is different. I think we have an exclusive session on the array also, arrays and beamforming. Maybe there we can actually look into the arrays. Arrays are different from the MIMO antennas. Maybe that's why I'm not going into the arrays, because we have one more session on the antenna arrays and beamforming. That's right. So just keep in mind that this MIMO is entirely different from the array. Array is used for the beamforming. Even for MIMO antenna, if you're using at the base station for beamforming, you actually need an array, not simple MIMO. So here, what are the promises this MIMO is going to have? You are going to have the effects of fading, multipath interference can be reduced. We can have a better connectivity because we are going to have more transmitter and more receiver. So there will not be no breaks in voice because one transmitter or one receiver is not receiving the signal, other receivers are still there. We have the faster downloads, more Mbps with the existing spectrum and lower power. And other communications are also used. So the major thing what we can say is we are going to introduce the diversity antennas, multiple antennas, transmitters and receiver, antenna diversity, receive diversity and transmit diversity. If you are going to place an array, you can also have the advantage of the beamforming, and we have this space division multiplexing also. You can combine the signals by transmitting through over the different antennas. So this is the beam forming. Now let us go through some of the examples of the antennas, what we can use for the MIMO system. As I mentioned, like that, you have the base station and you have the user. So base station, you have the more number of elements. User, you can have the less number of elements. So whatever the antennas right now, I am showing the published ones are with respect to the user, not the base station. Base station, you can actually go for the array of antennas, like 4x4 or 8x8 like that. But or single also, 1x8, 1x4 like this also. But these are the antennas, whatever the antennas we are publishing or whatever the antennas we are mostly doing the research is on the user antennas only. So in the MIMO antennas, we want to use more than one antenna. Again, these are for the transmitter and receiver, but from the application point of view, where actually you are going to place this antenna, these antennas are placed on the users and the mobile device, as I mentioned that. Because 5G, 6G, everything is regarding the mobile communication. This is on the mobile device. So here we want a more number of antennas placed on the either the mobile device or any MIMO system. So instead of one antenna, we want to have more than one antenna. Okay. This is a MIMO antenna, which is designed for a frequency of 28 gigahertz. At this frequency, this antenna is designed. So here a basic patch antenna is considered, which is a directional radiator. This patch antenna is a directional radiator. And this is modified. The rectangular patch is converted into an S shape. Okay. So this S shape is given and we can see the shift in the frequency. So the S shape is going to radiate at 28 gigahertz. Okay. This is a single antenna radiation. Now this is a fabricated one. And this is the return loss of this antenna, S11 measured and simulated. So this is the measured result. It is resonating at 28 gigahertz. And this is the bandwidth, minus 10 dB bandwidth. Okay. Now, instead of using one antenna, we want to use more than one antenna. So that now we have the benefits of that multipath. Or we can have the better capacity. So what is that MIMO antennas? We are going to place more than one antenna. So you are going to place two antennas, similar antennas. Both are going to resonate at the 28 gigahertz. We are going to place them side by side. Okay. So what's the spacing, actual spacing you need for the MIMO system? Because for actually, if you go for the MIMO system, actually, if you don't want any coupling, mutual coupling between the elements, you have to place it at maybe two wavelengths or three wavelengths like that. But that much wavelength, if you place, the size is also going to increase. So we are going to apply the techniques by which we can place them at a smaller distance. And we can also reduce the mutual coupling between the two elements. Because two elements are placed side by side, they are going to have the effect of the mutual coupling. We want to reduce the mutual coupling as far as possible. So by which we are going to apply different techniques. Let us see this antenna. No other techniques are applied, but still the mutual coupling is very less. So if you want to, you are going to have the two antennas. In addition to S11, we also want to see what is the S12 or S21. S12 or S21 will be the mutual coupling between the two elements. So if it must be less, so less than minus 20 dB, this is the S11, which is less than minus 10 dB at 28 gigahertz. So here, in which way you are going to place the elements in the MIMO system? So actually, like an array, they must be aligned in a same orientation. But if you come to the MIMO, you don't have to bother about the orientation. They can be aligned with a different orientation also, because the main purpose of the MIMO is to receive the multipath signals. So the alignment, you can put in the other alignments also. They need to be in the same linearly, like same wave orientation. Orientation can be different. So this is one way we can orient asymmetric orientation. This is the asymmetric orientation. In the symmetric orientation, if you see, this is a mutual coupling, S21 or S12. If you place asymmetric, the mutual coupling is reduced to a very far extent. So this is S21. So this one is preferred compared with this one because S21 is reduced. Okay. So this is S21 measured and simulated, and these are the antennas. This is the return loss. Now, to understand this MIMO antennas, we are going to design the similar frequency, same frequency, same bandwidth antennas. Alignment can be in any orientation. So, but what is the main consideration is the S21 must be as less as possible. And to evaluate these things, the coupling between the antennas, so some coefficients are developed. So this is one is such is called as the envelope correlation coefficient. In an envelope correlation coefficient indicates the degree of independence of the radiation patterns of the two antennas. So once the these two antennas, as I mentioned that the MIMO antennas, if you are going to two antennas are going to work like a separate antennas. If you are going to give the input to one antenna, other will be matched. Both antennas, you are not going to radiate at the same time. You are going to use them like a separate antennas only. One you are using means other has to be matched. Other is using, other has to be matched. So how much independent the radiation patterns are there? Single and what is the dependence? So to that, we have to calculate the envelope correlation coefficient. This is used to understand the level of coupling between the antenna ports in the MIMO system. Minimizing mutual coupling would involve reducing correlation coefficient between the port pairs. So again, this correlation coefficient is going to depend upon the S11 and S12 or S22 or S21. So this is calculated, this envelope correlation coefficient in terms of the S parameters. So it must be as much as less as possible. So 0.5. Preferable less than 0.5. Okay, is the value. And you have to calculate the envelope correlation coefficient for these multiple antennas and see how much is the correlation between them or how much independence is there. And then you have the one more parameter which is derived from this ECC. It is called as a diversity gain. So this diversity gain is the increase in the signal to interference ratio by using this multiple systems. So this diversity gain is determined as 10 into square root of 1 minus this rho e square. This is rho e square. So this is a diversity gain as increasing the signal to interference ratio as large as possible. So if this is small means this becomes large, 1 minus rho square. And the other parameter what we have to extract is the total active reflection coefficient. So the reflection coefficient is that reflected by incident. So what is the reflection coefficient due to all the ports in the MIMO system? Is the total reflection coefficients. So the sum of the total reflected, sum of the total, this is B is reflected, A is the incident. Summation, square root of summation of all the reflected powers. By square root of sum of all the incident powers. So this ratio is called as the total active reflection coefficient. Reflection coefficient of the entire system, not the single port. So this is called as the torque, again, which is dependent upon the S parameters. This is the expression given for calculating the torque. So for a MIMO system, you are designing a MIMO system. We have to see the S11, we have to see the S12. S22, S21, and we have to calculate the ECC diversity gain and torque and see what are these values, what the design frequency range. If these values are within the frequency, within the limits, then we can say that MIMO system is working in a good way. So this is the ECC and this is a diversity gain plotted. ECC less than, this is a small value, diversity gain is around 10. And this is the torque, total reflection coefficient. And one more thing is, as I mentioned, that this MIMO systems, we have to see its performance like a single element. So once this is fed as an input, we are going to exit this one. This has to be terminated by matched termination. Now, if you are going to give the input to this, we can see the fields only in this. There is no coupling, actually, we can see. This asymmetry has resulted in no coupling between the two elements. Similarly, this. If this is fed, means there is no coupling. You don't see any currents there. Okay. And these patch antenna is a directional radiation, as I mentioned that. So this is for the antenna one, and this is the antenna. Both are radiating separately, and you can see the patterns also. Okay. So here, in this particular example, whatever we have discussed, the MIMO antennas, we have the two antennas placed, and we have seen the mutual S12 and S21, they are very less. But in other cases, we can also reduce the mutual coupling between the elements by using the different techniques like EBGs. By placing the EBG structures between the antennas, you can reduce the mutual coupling. You can also place the metamaterial materials between the elements and a neutralizing line to reduce the mutual coupling. One example is there with the neutralizing line and defected ground structures. One more example I have taken using the defected ground structures to reduce the mutual coupling. And split ring resonators, metallic strips, self-decoupled structures. All these structures we can place between the antennas so that, there is a better isolation between the elements. So one such example for the MIMO system is we have the two antennas. These are the patch antennas with the probe feeding. So here these two antennas are at a lambda by 10 gap between the patch. They are very close to each other. Actually, if they are very so close means there is a lot of coupling between the elements. With that small spacing. So if something is given present here means it is coupled to this, something is coupled to this. So to avoid that, what is we have placed the insulators. This is one. Okay. So you can place some EBGs or AMCs and DGS and neutralizing lines by which you can reduce the coupling between these elements. So actually the MIMO antenna's design is around these things only. How we can reduce the mutual coupling between the elements is the one important factor for designing the MIMO antennas for the mobile devices. So here you can see the S11 and S21. This is minus 10 without insulator. With it insulator, you can see the reduction in the S2. Okay. So there is other way, like you can also place a metallic PEC between the two. So that now these two are not a couple, but this PEC, what it does now, it will also disturb its radiation because there is a reflection from the PEC now. So instead of PEC, you can also place an AMC by which you can reduce the mutual coupling between elements. So these are the two examples shown here, the matching S11 with the AMC, with the PEC and with the air. So you can see that the S11 is better improved. And S21 with the PEC is more because the proper conductor, there is no coupling between them, but return loss is not, S11 is not good. So here this is the AMC and this is the A. So this is how the elements or AMC is going to have a better coupling and better S11 also. And this is the spacing between the two elements. Okay. So this is one way by which we can reduce the mutual coupling between the MIMO systems. Like different examples are there by which you can have a better mutual coupling. Better means reduce the mutual coupling between elements. So one more example I have taken is for the MIMO antennas for 5G smartphones. Okay. So MIMO antennas, again, this is on the smartphone, a mobile device only. The few examples what I'm going to tell are initially for the mobile device only. So here, this is a antenna which is designed at the frequency 3.5, I think, 3.5 around that frequency in the C band. What is done is a ground plane is taken and here a AMC structure is placed, like sphere patches, artificial magnetic conductor is placed above the ground plane. And on the top, we have placed the F antennas, inverted F antennas. Okay? So the feed line and this is connected to the ground plane. So totally how many 8 F antennas are placed here? So you can see all the antennas are, no two antennas are in the same orientation. So we have rotated the orientation such a way that the mutual coupling is reduced. Same orientation, same currents will be induced. So mutual coupling will be more. So one way of designing the MIMO antennas, if you observe the MIMO antennas, you can see that the orientation will be, no two antennas are of the same orientation. So you can see 8 antennas. So no two are of the same orientation. That is how intellectually they have placed the antennas. By which automatically, because now they are of the different structures, their mutual coupling will also be reduced. So 8 elements are placed, 8 antennas are placed on the AMC. Let us see this AMC. You know that a perfect electric conductor will give 180 degrees phase shift, and AMC artificial magnetic conductor will give 0 degrees phase shift on reflection for the electric field. So here at this 3.5, you can see that there is a 0 degrees phase shift. And two things are there. There is a patch and there is an artificial magnetic conductor also. Two types of waves are there. One is, which is the wave on the patch, one which is wave on the magnetic conductor. So these two waves are going to add up and they are going to improve the return loss. This is what you can see. Antenna 1 and antenna 2. So this is a return loss. Okay. So here they have considered the 6 dB return loss, not the 10 dB. So they have considered the 6 dB return loss instead of the 10 dB return loss. Okay. They have given the 6 dB return loss instead of the 10 dB return loss from the frequency range 3.3 to 3.8 GHz with an efficiency of 50%. And if you see the other coupling, mutual coupling between S12, S13, S14, between all the elements, you can see they are very much less than minus 12 dB at this point. But here there is slight more, S18 is slightly more coupling is there. Okay. So these antennas are placed on the mobile device. Now similarly, one more antenna is there. That one is at 3.3 to 3.8 GHz frequency. And the one more is similar antennas are published for the 5G communications using the millimeter waves. And here, the in the previous example, AMC is used for having a better performance MIMO antennas. And in this example, DGS is used, by which you can improve the performance by having a better isolation and by having the more bandwidth in the S11, minus 10 dB bandwidth. So here also, they have considered a published, this is also published paper, I given the reference here at the bottom of this slide. So here a basic single element is designed and it is placed into two elements. Okay? And it is placed into two elements array. And this itself is used as a single element. So this is one element and this is two elements. This itself is used as a two element array, but single antenna only. And here a DGS is placed with a circle and with this rectangular patch in between these two, by which the radiation characteristics are improved by placing in between these two and the ground plane. So this is the DGS. So like this, each one is a one unit, one unit, one unit, one unit. Each has two elements array, and a DGS is placed here between this, by which the characteristics are improved. And the mutual coupling between all the four elements is further reduced by using this another jigsaw shaped DGS. Okay, this is the top side and this is the bottom side. In between you have the substrate. So this is, again, if you see this MIMO antennas, all of them are in different orientation. Like, so by natural orientation itself, the mutual coupling will be reduced to definitely, and this DGS and AMC, they are going to still reduce the mutual coupling. And not only that, they will also improve the bandwidth, they will also improve the, we have to place them to improve the radiation characteristics. So here if you see, this is the S11 of the single element and this is the S11 of the element, two element. Okay, this is the S11 without DGS, and if you see S11 with the DGS also. Okay, so here you can see for the single element and then for the two element and without DGS, there is a better improvement in the return loss and the S11 and S22. So these are the, if you observe with DGS, you can see that the that mutual coupling is getting reduced, that minus, it is, they are becoming less than minus 10 dB. This S21 and S43. Okay, so this is how you have to calculate, like see how you can improve the performance of this MIMO system. And if you are going to exit one antenna, all other antennas have to match termination, because only one antenna is going to effectively radiate or receive it. Assuming that others are not transmitting. So here, if you see, this is the antenna 3 is excited, and you see the coupling in the other elements. Surface current distribution. Okay. So this is a fabricated antenna where you have placed, this is the top layer, this is the bottom layer, and the measurement setup, and the results are given. So you can see you have the four port MIMO antenna with the DGS. This is the one application. So if you see, you are going to the measured and simulated results are matching very well. And the reflection coefficients and the transmission coefficients. Transmission coefficient means that mutual coupling between them must be as far small as possible. And you can see, so this is a radiation pattern of the elements in the two planes, orthogonal planes, at 28 gigahertz and 27 gigahertz. Two frequencies, they are plotted. You can see the radiation pattern, the directional radiation pattern of the two elements. They are the patches antennas. And similarly, for this four-port antenna with a defected ground structure, the ECC and DG, diversity gain, are calculated. Once you know the S11, S12, S21, you can calculate this ECC and diversity gain. So the ECC is plotted between the two elements, any two elements, 1, 2, 1, 3, 1, 4, 1, 5. 1, 1, 4 only, two like this, 2, 3, 3, 2, and 3, 4 and 4, 3. Okay, so these are, they are all less than a 0.4 or 0.6 maximum within that frequency range. And the diversity gain, it is coming around 10 for these cases. So you can say that the performance wise they are okay. And one more parameter is also calculated, which is called as the channel capacity loss. So this channel capacity loss, it will provide the list of channel capacity loss during the correlation process. So whatever the losses we are going to have in the correlation process, bits per second per hertz, okay, the loss in bits per second per hertz due to this correlation process, it is given as channel capacity loss. And this is determined with the help of, again, the S11 and S22. So sigma 11 between two antennas, anyway, this is also between two ports, or two and ports we can call. S11, 12, or this is the sigma 21 and sigma 12. So this is called as a correlation matrix. So you can find the channel CCL, channel capacity loss, from this, again, S parameters. And if you plot this as 0.4 bits per second per hertz, this is a CCL for the proposed MIMO antenna. And one more parameter also we have to estimate for this MIMO antenna is the mean effective gain. So this is the mean received power in the fading environment. How much power is received by this total antenna system is the mean received power in the fading environment. So here this is obtained as 0.5 into 1 minus sigma J12K Sij. We are going to calculate S11, S12, all those things, add up them. And this is going to give the mean received, mean effective gain of all the antennas at different frequencies. K is the number of antennas, I represent the antennas. Okay. So these are the some of the parameters what we have to show for evaluating the performance of the MIMO systems. Okay. And similarly, some other antennas are also there where we have the smart antennas where we can use for the two frequency bands. Previously, we are using only for the one frequency band. We can also propose two types of antennas. So here in this, we have the antennas for the 5G systems. We have the antennas for the 4G systems. So 5G systems, two antennas are placed. And 4G, 5G, these 8 antennas are placed. So this is a element of single element of the 5G. This is for the 4G. Okay. So here for the 4G, it is covering 850, 900, 1800 and 1900 of the GSM. And UMTS 2100, LTE 2300 and 2500 in for the 4G. And the 5G in the C-band from 3400 to 3600 megahertz. So these two antennas are combined in the 4G, for both 4G and 5G antennas. These antennas are designed for the smartphone application. So if you see, like, one is the 4G is for the 0.8 and 0.9, and other 1.8 to 2.5 is covered here. 3:1 if you take. For some papers, the 3:1 VSWR is also accepted, like -60 dB return loss is also accepted for the smartphones, but most of the times you are going for the -10 dB return loss. So here this is for the 4G communications, and this is for the 3.4 to 3.6 is for the 5G communication, 3.4 to 3.6. So the S11 reflection coefficient at each port is represented here. And these are the transmission coefficients or the mutual coupling between the any two elements. Okay. And this is the antenna efficiency plotted for the antennas. Okay. So now if you see the entire module, you have the two antennas here. So as I mentioned, that neutralizing line, this is called as a neutralizing line, which is going to reduce the mutual coupling. And you also have the extended ground planes, which is going to give some additional inductance to the lines. This is the lines. And these are the 8 antennas, which are proposed for the 5G. These are the for the 4G systems. So you have the connectors placed here, and this connection is extended through this cable here. You have the connections for 4G. So you can see that all of them are separate. And instead of the spacing, we have to see what is the mutual coupling, what is the S12, or we have to calculate that ECC and CCL for this MIMO antennas. So S parameters, S11 and S12, S21 we have to calculate, and from that we are going to calculate the other ECCs, CCL for the antennas. So ECC, once you know ECC, you can calculate the divestigan, which is square root of 1 minus rho e square, and the radiation patterns of the antennas, which are excited separately. So depending upon these antennas, this you can see that these patterns are an omnidirectional patterns, like circle and figure of eight, all the antennas. But at some frequencies, they are not figure of eight, but they must be preferably a figure of eight. One plane, circle in the other plane. Okay. And this is a CCL. For the these antennas. Okay. This is one more antenna which is given for the fifth generation system, communication systems. So here at the 28 gigahertz. So here you have the triple circular shaped rings on a by an infinity shaped shell. Okay. So this is a 4LN antennas, and here these are the monopole antennas. You can see the ground plane here. So again, these are going to have the omnidirectional radiation pattern. Regular patch will get the direction. This will be the omnidirectional radiation. Four antennas aligned in all the four directions. And we can see the reflection coefficient. And this is the transmission coefficient. See, the transmission coefficients are very much less. All of them are less than -30 dB. Okay. And these are the ECC, less than 0.16 between any two antennas. So we have seen some of the antennas which are used for the which are used for the mobile devices. Okay. Any doubts? So similarly, all the antennas what we have discussed are on the mobile devices. As I mentioned,
Madam, you are currently explained about the 28 gigahertz frequency bands. Usually in satellite communication, we are using the same 28 gigahertz bands. Yes. Does this cause interference in deploying cellular communication?
The interference part, maybe it must be taken care by the licensing. So in the region wherever you are using the 28 gigahertz, so there you cannot use that frequency for the satellite communication. So that will be taken care by the FCC. You have to follow the guidelines if you want to use it for the mobile communications.
Okay. Yeah.
Because anyway, it will be regulation is there now. We cannot use any frequency whatever we like, because all the license, all the spectrum is licensed. Entire spectrum is licensed. So according to the license, only we have to follow.
Yes, actually, why I asked now, because whenever we are deploying or propose the higher frequency, usually we will have a research on the frequency bands which are not commonly used by other technologies. But in this particular 28 gigahertz, a lot of research is going on. However, satellite communication is also deployed deeply in the same band. That is why I asked why the research community is more interested in this particular band. Even though it is already deployed.
Because in that actually, because 5G is has to be deployed at night. If that in the actual deployment, that licensing has to be taken care. Maybe for research purpose, we can proceed with the 28 gigahertz also. But actually, while deploying that 5G, that regulations, they will take care of the licensing, whether it is used for the satellite means they cannot provide that band to the 5G. Or if it is used for 5G, for satellite, they have to provide a different band. That interference part will be taken care by the regulation.
Anyway, both technology cannot be simultaneously deployed.
Yes. Okay. Any other doubts? Because now it's going on continuously. Maybe one, two questions I can take before going with the. Because the till now I have covered the mobile device antennas, MIMO antennas. They're not arrays. One more point. Then no other doubts. I will go with this.
One more participant has asked a doubt, sir.
In the chat box, sir.
In the chat box, they have typed it. Which simulator could be used for designing this MIMO antenna?
Particularly, I think I don't suggest any simulator, because many things are there. You have the HFSS, you have the other one is CST is there, you have the REMCOM, XFTD is there, and you can also use IE3D, and many other software also have come into picture. But CST and HFSS.
Licensed software or?
You can use the open software. There is no issue. But only thing is the simulation time, because if you're going for a bigger structure, then maybe actually you have to go for the licensed software. But for these MIMO antennas, once you are only the issue will come only when you're going for the antenna on a platform. It requires more space. Then these unlicensed softwares will not support. Otherwise, the free versions or cracked versions you can use. I don't say, but
which one is best, madam, from your experience?
HFS is the best one, because in HFSS, the return loss is also good, more towards the measurement results, and gain is also a very good correlation between the simulation and the measurement in the HFSS compared with the CST. CST, now usually the projection of gain is more. Actually, you will not get so much gain while doing the measurement. But CST is more comfortable for working, because everything, now some of the settings will take it by default. Whereas HFSS, you have to do many settings, but CST, that problem is not there. Maybe you can initially go for the CST and then come back to the HFSS. Both are similar versions only. Only few steps, because now the procedure is same. Only 2-3 where to select, how to select is only 2-3 issues are there. Otherwise, both are same. HFS and CST are both are have the same sequence of steps. But for the beginner, CST may be a very it will be more comfortable. But HFS is the best for if you go for the advanced cases. Now, if you want to actually go for the publication of the work, I usually suggest HFSS. CST is also okay, and you have the other also. XFTD is there. IE3D nowadays we are not using that much, but if you have still, you can use IE3D also. Any software you can use, not an issue. Okay.
Ma'am, one more query from the participant, Professor Ravansindappa Kinangi. In MIMO, only one antenna is excited always, madam.
Yes, sir. Only one antenna excited means we have to see the it is only giving the performance, like it's a separate antenna. We are not what we have to say is like because now we have the multiple antennas now. We'll assume that only this antenna is receiving. So whatever this antenna is receiving, it has to receive only from the free space. It should not receive from the nearby and transmitting antenna. It's adjacent antennas. And again, on that condition only, we are going to make it working. It's not like an array. In an array, all the antennas will be transmitting, all the antennas will be receiving. But in a MIMO, we have to see the system is like only that single antenna is transmitting or single antenna is receiving. So there is some difference between the MIMO antenna and antenna array. So as I mentioned that MIMO antenna is not an antenna array. We have to see that it's the only antenna which is receiving. Others are acting like a passive devices. So they can be there, but they are not transmitting. They can receive. Anyway, receiving is not an issue. But while doing the transmission, we have to assume that it's only one is transmitting. And receiving also, we'll assume that it is receiving. Even if others are receiving, the others are receiving, that effect on the our main antenna must be as minimum as possible. Because there is no, that's why we are more concentrating on mutual coupling. Mutual coupling means, if I am speaking, means the other person will not get induced with my currents, whatever I am present. So if that induction, currents induction is very much less, means we can say that even if both are receiving, there is no problem. That's why all these ECC we are calculating means only to see that even if both are receiving, the disturbance of one on other will be as minimum as possible. So that's why for evaluating, we'll see that only one is working. But in real-time performance, because if you maintain the interference as low as possible, we can see that both are receiving. Yeah, am I clear?
Yes, madam, you would have been clarified.
Yeah.
Ma'am, shall I proceed further? The few more questions are in the chat box.
Yeah, one, two, quickly I will take and then I will go. Because now it's continuous, now monotonous now, so questions are more, we'll have better interaction and that continuity will be more. Is it possible to design 8 MIMO antenna which contains 8 different radiating? So again, if you are going for the different radiating elements, the concept of that similarity will be lost now. Because after the MIMO antenna, again we have to sum those things or difference those things, and we have to put some algorithm. Whatever the signal we are receiving for the MIMO antennas, again they are sent through an algorithm. So if they are sent through an algorithm, the weight factor of the antenna must be one only same. Otherwise, we have to put a different weight factor for the antennas also. We have put only the channel matrix I mentioned now in that figure. Transmitter is there, receiver is there, only channel weights are there. Antenna weights we did not consider. Why? We are assuming that the antennas are similar. Otherwise, all the antennas are different means what happens? Antenna is also going to give some scaling. So we have to construct that effect, which will become more complex. So that's why as far as possible, if you know, you can also configure that antenna and give the weight, then it's okay. Otherwise, no, we cannot actually, for with this mathematics, we have to see that the antennas are similar. That's the thing. Which technique is more suitable for reducing the mutual coupling? The first, as I suggested, is the alignment is the first thing, which is going to reduce the mutual coupling to the least thing as much as possible. And then DGS is also a very good technique, because DGS is very simple. It can be applied in the ground. And depending on the, alignment, if you're going to have the, actually I have shown one example where the monopoles are the 3D antennas. If there are 3D antennas, you can put some insulators or like AMC type. If there are planar antennas, actually you can go for either for the DGS or for the whatever is placed on the planar only. Again, on the how the antennas are placed, you can either go for the meta materials or you have to go for the DGS. That's the only option if there are planar antennas. How massive MIMO methods are helpful for industrial IoT applications? So massive MIMO, just I am going to discuss the advantage of the massive MIMO. Now coming to the next antennas at the massive MIMO, what is the advantage of the massive MIMO? The next part I am going to discuss that. Like what the main thing is the beam forming. and how the antennas are placed and what are the difficulties are there, those things are discussed. The main advantage of the MIMO, massive MIMO, is the beamforming, because we can focus the radiation in a particular direction. The more the number of elements, the more the intensity, and the more the narrow beam you can have. So it is definitely more useful, because we are having the more number of elements. Focusing, we can have the better beam forming if you're having the massive MIMO. Okay, so next I'll go to my presentation. Okay. So as we mentioned that the MIMO system, you have the multiple antennas, you have the massive MIMO. So in a MIMO system, at the transmitter, at the base station and the user, every time now we are having the base station, we are having the users. So base station will be communicating with the mobile terminals or the users or the mobile device or the cell phone, whatever it is. Okay, so the convention is only 2 to 8 elements, but we are going for the more number of elements, 100 to 1000 like this. And you can, these base stations can communicate parallelly to 1 to 4 users. But if you are going for the massive MIMO, because you are going to have more number of elements, you have the advantage of dividing the elements into subarrays also. You can have the beam forming in this massive MIMO, better beam forming, because 2 to 8 is not possible. You cannot have a very good beam forming. But here you have that spatial multiplexing, or spatially you can separate multiple axes. You are going to separate them by using the increasing the more number of antennas. So you can also in parallelly communicate with the 16 to 64 users here, mobile devices at this case. So the basic difference between the MIMO and massive MIMO is the base station is going to increase the number of antennas. The user, the mobile terminal, don't have to increase the antennas. Only the base station is going to increase the number of antennas on its tower, cell tower. So by increasing the number of antennas, you are going to have the better spatial multiplexing. Depending upon the number of antennas, you have the better reliability and array gain. You can have the beam forming by which you can focus the radiation in a particular direction, better way. So these are the advantages. Depending upon the number of transmitting and receiving antennas, you can have the diversity gain is NTNR and the multiplexing gain is minimum of NRNT and the channel capacity. 1 plus SNR, NR and minimum of NT and NR. Number of antennas for the single user, and this is the error probability. Its error probability is also reduced. So by increasing the number of transmitting antennas, you are going to significantly increase the spectral efficiency. So increase the spectral efficiency means the same spectrum can be used many times. Like we have the same concept, whatever we have applied in the cell, dividing the cell. We have divided the cell area into different cells, and in each cell, we are going to use the frequency, same frequency. That's a cellular. Even in the cell itself, we can use the same frequency by using the advantage of the beam forming. So you have the beam formed. So that means the array is there. So beam forming is going to improve the spectral efficiency, because now that you are not radiating in the entire 360 degrees direction, you are going to radiate only to that particular user. So if you are going to do that, you can use the same frequency to the other user also, because that radiation is limited over that, is becoming narrow, and by which you can improve the spectral efficiency many times in this massive MIMO, which is not possible in the conventional MIMO. So you have the uplink and downlink. The mobile users are going to communicate with the base stations. And base station is going to communicate with the users. So here you can see that it is going to, because arrays are there, na, it is going to form a focused radiation. Previously, again, this is also, it has the 360 degrees communication. But now instead of transmitting in all the, sorry, in the in that plane uniformly. Instead of transmitting uniformly in that plane, it is going to transmit focusedly to the point only, to the user only. It will send that because it's a base station and user has to communicate. Now whatever this user is communicating with the base station, that information need not be sent to the other mobile device. So that's why the whatever it has to send, it is going to send in a focused way, by which you are going to have the more advantage in the massive memory because the spectral efficiency can be increased here. So this beamforming is only possible if you have the more number of elements which are placed in the form of an array, not like a MIMO. In a MIMO, we want to avoid mutual coupling because we are working on a different concept there. We want to combine them so that we have a better signal. In a MIMO, in an array, that beamforming is there. We are going to increase the more number of elements. We are going to have a better narrow beam. So here, by using this beamforming technique, you are going to have a better spectral efficiency. That's a major advantage in the massive MIMO. Because anyway, it's on the base station, so the users don't have to carry so many antennas also. It's only the at the base stations we are going to place so many antennas. So if you are going to have 4x4 elements, this is the beam, radiated beam. If you are going to have 16x16 elements, the gain is improved and the beam is also becoming focused, 32x32, 64x64. So if all the elements you are going to use, 64x64, this is the beam. You can have this radiation in a focus to the user only, we will radiate. So this is how, by using the array, like two-dimensional, it can, because 60 planar array now, both sides it can change. Okay. So that's why in the massive MIMO, you have the more advantages compared with the conventional MIMO. So the number of elements will be greater than 16. Pilot contamination will be high here. This is the disadvantage of this one. Throughput is high. Antenna coupling is high. Bit error rate is low. Noise resistance is high. Diversity gain is high. Energy efficiency is high. Because the energy, how energy is efficient, we are going to focus it on a particular direction only. You're not going to scatter in all directions. Cost is also high. Complexity is high. Scalability is high. Link stability is also high. Antenna correlation is also high. Okay. So this is how a base station massive MIMO is going to work. So here you have the users, okay? You have the number of elements, base station with the array of ML antennas, and you are going to use it to the decoder, and each user data is given after decoding to K. Now, while you are going to transmit data for K users, you are transmitting, and you have the precoder, and then you have the base station for N, and you can transmit. And one more thing, while doing the transmission, you don't have to, all the antennas don't have to transmit also. So that is what we mentioned, that in that MIMO, it doesn't have to transmit one data. All the transmitter doesn't have to transmit one data. Each antenna can transmit different data. Or a set of antennas can transmit different data. In massive MIMO, we don't call it single element. We'll call it as a subarray because we'll not use one antenna. We can use a number of subarrays. Subarrays can transmit different data, multiple data. And all of them are going to receive. So whichever information this user one has to take, they will take here. And here there are some challenges with the massive MIMO. One is the hardware impairments, like the phase noise in the system. Many number of elements are there, IQ imbalance between amplifier distortion, magnetization noise. These are the some of the hardware problems. Phase noise is one problem, and between IQ signals, distortion is there. For so many antennas are there, magnetization noise is there. These are some of the problems which are present in the massive MIMO system. And we want to reduce them to the minimum as much as possible so that we can have a better system. Okay. And due to large number of antennas, there is a mutual coupling between antenna elements, which changes the load and causes distortion. So massive MIMO also promises to reduce the radiated power 100 times than the conventional MIMO. The power consumption by the baseband hardware and hardware conductor increases with linearity with an increase in n number of elements, PLLs we are using. So how to reduce the hardware impairments? So what we can do is here, because arrays are there now, there is more scope for using the employing the different algorithms also for overcoming the challenges. Like you can have impairment algorithms like phase noise estimation, compensation and digital pre-distortion are feasible with large number of antennas as computational complexity increases exponentially. The phase shift problem can be significantly reduced by design of smart transmission physical layer schemes. To reduce cost of baseband signal processing, it is highly desirable to build dedicated hardware, and low cost amplifier of the transmitter can be mitigated by having a low peak to average power ratio with this. Okay. So here in the uplink and downlink, we are having some challenges, definitely like pilot contamination, pre-coding and channel estimation. Some issues are there which can be taken up. Like we have the one more disadvantage is the signal detection. Because all the users are transmitting here, there is a problem with interference with the signal. Uplink signal, but the uplink signal detection becomes computationally complex. Which user is sending which signal? It becomes a complex one, but still it can be overcome by adopting the very better algorithms. Like better throughput performance with lower computational complexity can be obtained if you are going for a better detectors, like nonlinear detectors, like square detect decoder, successive interference cancellation, and which is also come to the signal part. And linear detectors like ML, maximum likelihood, zero forcing, MMSE. You can use the detectors and you can overcome those drawbacks like by using the MIMO system. And one more field which is open more for the this MIMO is the machine learning and deep learning. So wherever you have that pilot contamination, channel estimation and pre-coding and this signal detection, you can use them. Are the user scheduling also. You can use the machine learning and deep learning. Machine learning and deep learning has very good scope in the massive MIMO system. So many algorithms can be developed, and you can also use this neural networks and deep learning networks, neural networks for all the applications where you are going to give the data and train the network initially, and in the real time, it can go for the actual better estimation. And because it's in machine learning, it's in it will train continuously on its own. Whenever the data is getting modified, it will get it itself trained, like artificial intelligence, it will get itself trained. And by using these algorithms, you can also improve this MIMO system performance. Like we have the, this is for the channel estimator. You can use it in many places. This machine learning and deep learning networks can be used. It has a very good scope in the massive MIMO system. Okay. So you can also use for beamforming, channel estimation, signal detection, load balancing, optimization of the available spectrum. So these are the all areas which are present for applying the machine learning and deep learning in MIMO system, massive MIMO systems particularly. So you can see, you can identify the user and you can set the weights to see where the beam has to be focused. You can, depending on the conditions, you can estimate the channel estimation and determine the values. And signal detection, which user is what. So the network, the algorithms can be trained and then you can use them. And you can also allow the spectrum effectively. So machine learning and deep learning has very good application in the MIMO system. Channel data can be considered as a big data, and several machine learning tools can be used to predict the massive MIMO channels. Accurate prediction of the channel via the machine learning would significantly improve the throughput of the massive MIMO system. So this is how you can, many areas are there. Machine learning has also been used for efficient beam alignment in massive MIMO systems to track the users efficiently. Machine learning and deep learning techniques are also used for uplink signal detection in massive MIMO. Because in all the places, wherever you have the this ambiguity, so you can use the this machine learning and deep learning networks, and you can improve the performance. So very good scope is there for ML and deep learning networks. So these are some of the base station antennas which are developed by different universities. This is the Rice University Bell Labs. There it has 64 antennas okay, placed here, and it can accommodate, it can communicate with 15 users parallelly with 18 bits per second hertz, sorry, 85 bit per second per hertz, 1/64 power consumption. So this is the model developed by the Rice University, February 2012. This is the Rice University Bell Labs Agros Argos V2. It has 96 antennas and it can communicate with 32 users. And it has a, it is in 2013, 120 antennas and 36 users. So 128 antennas at present. So this is a antenna array at the base station. So these are the models developed by the different universities in collaboration with the Bell Labs, these two, and this is with the Lund University, Lingpong, Lingkoping. So these are the base station antennas. What you can see is you have the arrays. And these are the first, this again, these are the as base station antenna, 64 antennas developed by Samsung mobile base station. This is one more mobile base station at 27.925 gigahertz, so 500 bandwidth EDD, and 64 elements and 34. Beamwidth is 10 degrees, channel coding is LDPC, modulation is QPSK or 16 QAM, and the support, so 1.1056 Mbps, 52 Mbps, 264 Mbps, up to 2 kilometers range. So the maximum range, it is up to 2 kilometers. You can use this system up to 2 kilometers, line of sight distance. Greater than 10 dB transmitter power headroom. So these are the very smaller versions, which you can use for the different, like whatever the faculty has asked, participant has asked for the industry applications. These are the mobile versions which you can use it up to 2 kilometers range. So for a small scale applications also, these can be applied. Okay. And what I said is the one advantage of this MASMM is the beamforming, baseband precoder, analog and RF precoder. So what we are doing here is, because using this array, we can form the beams, multiple beams, and we can also use the beam steering. So these are the users. So these users, the feedback will be given, and accordingly it is can align the beam also. So the arrays are present on the base station antennas. In the base station, you are going to place array of antennas. Okay. So in the array of antennas, so you can have different number of, like 4x4, 16x16, like 32x32, 64x64, like different elements are present. And in each element, you are going to have two antennas, which are placed for two polarizations, two perpendicular polarizations, for like vertical and horizontal. So each one antenna consists of two elements with two perpendicular polarizations. So you can transmit on both polarizations or one polarizations, or you can receive in any one of the polarizations also. So this is regarding the one element in the antenna array. So actually how these antenna arrays are divided as, they are divided as subarrays. So in the subarray, you have the two elements, or you can have a different number of elements in the subarrays also. So the entire antenna array is divided into subarrays, and it is operated as a subarray. Okay. So here, if you're going to use say 8 elements, you are going to have a 6 dB gain. So if you are going to use 4 elements, you are having a 3 dB. And we are having 2 elements, you are having some X. Above this, if you double these elements, power will be increased by 3 dB. Double them, power is going to increase by 6 dB. So this is the number of elements transmitting. You are going to have the increase in gain by 3 dB. So this is the array gain. So if you are going to use it, one array as a, all the elements in the subarray as one array. So 0 dB and 6 dB. This is the array gain. This is the total gain. So if you're going to divide it into two, entire element is divided into two subarrays. So each subarray has a 3 dB gain, and it has a 3 dB, you'll have the 6 dB gain. So each subarray is divided into two elements. It has four subarrays. So 6 dB here and plus something. It will be 6 dB here. So one advantage of this is the more the subarrays, so you have the more the beam steering, you have the better control on the beam steering. gain anyway, you will, when you are going to operate this, you have the same gain, but you can have a better control on the beam steering by dividing the entire array into subarrays. So instead of transmitting it in the one direction, you're going to transmitting in the other directions. Massive MIMO is an extension of MIMO only, but with essentially groups together antennas at the transmitter and receiver to provide better throughput and better spectrum efficiency. So it's not only the space, you are also going to combine the antennas on the transmitter side, so by which you can you are increasing the beam formations, thereby you are increasing the spectral efficiency. So here the macro stations are also have developed, like we have become seen the compact base station. So this is a previously we have the antennas and the base station. Now you can compare two base stations and combine the antennas. And whatever the modules which are required for controlling the antennas, radio receivers, they are also incorporated in the antennas itself. And we are going to have a very integrated antenna, very compact base station also, which can be it's more or less like a portable also. You can have very compact base stations also. The technology has improved, and you can have a very compact base stations where we are going to have the radio server. We are going to run a fiber cable and the DC supply only. Only these two we are going to have with the base station. Okay. So in the MIMO antenna, we can either go for the single user MIMO or multi user MIMO, where the signal to interference ratio will be split between the users. So beamforming is one of the main advantage of the massive MIMO, where we can target the concentrate the entire energy into the user and reducing interference to other users. Other users, they don't have to actually receive this. And you are also having that spatial diversity, because you are going to have the beam forming, you are going to provide better isolation between the users also. And you can also use the antennas for having a better multiple access technique also. One such type of a technique is called as the multiple access. You can access the base station by using a reconfigurable antenna multiple access, which is called as the RAMA, reconfigurable multiple access. This is one type of multiple access technique. That can support transmission of multiple radiation beams with one RF chain. You can transmit the various radiation beam by forming the beams at the transmitter side, and you can use the base station beams via one RF chain. A single base station is equipped with millimeter wave reconfigurable antenna, and each beam of the antenna serves one user, where the users are not aligned with the same direction. So here multiple beams can be generated by using this reconfigurable antenna, where you can actually communicate with the multiple users here. So let us take, this is the base station. Here you have the different TSA antennas, and you have the feed network, okay? So these are the tapered slot antennas. You have the feed network. This is a spherical lens. So if you're going to connect, you can select which antenna you're going to excite, and then we are going to, this spherical lens is helping to form the multiple far field pencil beams. So you have very narrow beams. So this is by which you can transmit, you can identify the location and you can transmit in that particular direction. Or you can combine two elements and form an array pattern, or you can have a better beam also. So here lies the major thing is in the feed network. We have to design the feed network in such a way that you are going to have the beams in the aligned direction. Okay, so this is a TSA antenna. Tapered slot antenna is used as a reconfigurable, and you can generate the beams. So feed network is also very important here. And beam steering. So it's not only the beam forming, you must be able to rotate the beam in any direction is the beam steering. That means you must be able to steer the beam. So steering multiple reconfigurable independent beams and routing the power among us, these beams are the two properties of the reconfigurable antenna. You can also form the beam and you can also steer the beam also of this advantage. So RAMA with the partial CSI and channel estimation, and this is the other one. So these are some of the benefits of the MIMO antennas, and the challenges are where we can work on are the pilot contamination, channel estimation, pre-coding, user scheduling, hardware impairments, energy efficiency, and signal detection. So these are the topics where we can work on with the different algorithms, and then we can suggest a few models for the massive MIMO also. And after this millimeter waves, as I mentioned, that we have the terahertz band also, 5G and 6G. So 6G is also open. We can also work on the 6G, which is called as the ultra massive MIMO. So in the ultra massive MIMO, we are going to use the terahertz band, and we are going to use the plasmonic materials, okay, as antennas and transceivers to achieve the capacity of the terahertz band. Materials such as the graphene and metamaterials can be built as nano antennas and transceivers. So UM MIMO can take advantage of this miniature antennas transceivers to provide higher spatial multiplexing and beamforming. So one advantage is when you are going for the terahertz, anyway the sizes will be very small, but we have to go for the other materials, not the whatever the materials we are going to use at the microwaves or the millimeter waves. We have to go for the plasmonic materials, and we are also have to use the graphene and metamaterials for building the antennas, not the regular conductors. Then this ultra massive MIMO is also very good technology, which can be used for the shorter distances. And some of the challenges are the fabrication of the plasmonic nano array antennas, channel estimation, pre-coding, signal detection. All these will also be there, whatever are there for the 5G, it will also be there for the 6G. These are the challenges what has to be worked out for the developing the ultra massive MIMO system, which we can propose for the 6G. So these are the references what I have seen. And any questions? And thank you. And any questions? Because I want to give some time.
Thank you so much, madam. Can we have Mr. Kaushik, sir, if there are any questions, we will ask to madam.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, sir. Ma'am, there is a few queries from the participants. Shall I proceed, madam?
Yes.
Okay, ma'am. The question from participant Professor Praveen Jaron: what is the significance of PAPR?
Okay. Significance of peak to average power ratio. This is mostly a communication oriented topic. Maybe I may not be the right person, but by using this, I think better you talk with a communication person, because I'm working on the antenna side.
Sir, Kaushik sir. Kaushik sir, can we have the next question? Kaushik sir?
Sir, just a minute, sir. Shall I proceed to another question, madam?
Yes, sir.
Okay. The participant, Professor Leela Bitla: how to control power in MIMO, multi-users MIMO? Is it possible, madam?
Control power, it depends upon how much you want to transmit. Okay. How much you want to transmit depends upon where the user is, how much distance you want to transmit. So depending upon how much distance you want to transmit, you have to see how much power you have to transmit. Depending upon that, you are going to set the source to transmit that much power. So you are going to have that fixed transmission coefficient. You have to calculate, you have to estimate for any link, either for the optical link or any link. You have to see where the user is present, what is the gain of the receiving antenna, what is the gain of the transmitting antenna, by which actually you have to set the range of the source of the power at the base station. So both sides, it depends. Actually, that link design equation, a link design has to be done. So initially, while setting up any base station, they are going to calculate the link design. They are going to see all the parameters in that surrounding environment. They will calculate, estimate how much losses are present in the environment, how much is the, what is the gain of the transmitter, what is the gain of the receiver. And considering all the points, they are going to see what is the actually the transmitted power by the base station. And accordingly, they are going to set the power. I think that is the answer. I understood from your question. Is this what you have asked or anything different?
Yes, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am. The last final question from the participant, Patrick Satish: how can we steer the beam practically?
Practically, beam steering. I think actually one session is there dedicated for you for the antenna array and beam forming. They will answer, but still I'm going to tell. You are going to have the similar antennas placed aligned in the same similar orientation. You have to change the phase delay. Like all, maybe generally IFS says that four people are there, four people are throwing a ball. So if all of them are throwing a ball, you will receive the receive all the balls when you are going to stand perpendicular to them. You will receive all the balls. You are in a other orientation. You are not perpendicular to them, you are inclined to them. You want to receive the ball. So how they have to throw, the person who is near have to throw with a delay. The person who is farther from you have to throw in advance. So if they are throwing the balls within that time delay, you can receive all the balls at the in that particular inclination. So the same way array will also work. If you want to actually rotate the beam, you have to change the delay so that they are going to add up in a particular direction and they'll get separated in a particular direction. So you are, that delay is called as a phase shifter. I think I have answered.
Sir, anything else? Shall we proceed? Sir, okay. Thank you, Professor. Starting from fundamentals of 5G communication systems, capacity enhancement techniques, design techniques for antenna for MIMOs, challenges involved, smart antenna techniques, beamforming techniques, tips for reducing the mutual coupling between the antennas, MIMO antennas for 5G smartphones, 4G, 5G, multiple antennas for future smartphone applications, antennas for 28 GHz, frequency band applications, massive MIMO, role of machine learning, deep learning in massive MIMO, what to list out, reconfigurable antennas for 5G, millimeter wave communication systems, ultra massive MIMO. Great, madam. Great to know about it. I'm sure that all the participants are benefited. They have had a great feast today and an insight into the topic also. Thank you so much for throwing light into the areas of MIMO and antennas for MIMO and 5G. Thank you, madam. Indeed, we are gifted to have you with us for the last 2 hours. Great, madam. Hearty thanks. Informative session. May I now request our beloved professor Ramya madam to propose a formal vote of thanks. Over to Ramya madam.
Yes, sir. Am I audible, sir?
Yes.
Sir?
Yes. Yes.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. Very good afternoon, one and all present here. It is a great privilege for me to propose vote of thanks for this session. I take this opportunity to express thanks to our secretary, Sri S. Ravindran, sir, without whose wholehearted support and appreciation, this FDP would not have marched towards this level. I thank you, sir, for your moral support to conduct this FDP. I wish to say thanks to our dynamic and flexible person, Principal Dr. D. Valvan, sir, for giving full support and valuable guidance to conduct this FDP. I take this opportunity to thank our beloved Dean R&D, Dr. Y. Venkatramani, sir, for his support and encouragement in conducting this program. I would like to convey my thanks to Dr. M. Shanti, ma'am, head of EC department, for her kind support and encouragement in conducting this FTP program. On behalf of entire EC department, I would like to thank our honorable resource person of this session, Dr. D. Vakula, ma'am, associate professor, Department of EC, National Institute of Technology, Warangal, Telangana. I would like to express our gratitude from the bottom of my heart to Vakula ma'am for giving excellent coverage on massive MIMO devices and circuits. Session was highly informative and excellent, ma'am. I'm sure that participants will definitely get benefited from your lecture. I thank our convener, Dr. V. Mohan sir, associate professor, for arrangement and conduction of this ATEL FTP. I would like to thank the program coordinators, Mr. V. Kaushik sir and Mr. S. D. Sairam sir, for their wonderful efforts in arranging this session. I would also like to thank the faculties who participated from other colleges in and around India during this pandemic situation and made this event more interactive. Lastly, I would like to say thanks to my dear colleagues who have made this event as a successful one. Stay safe. Once again, thank you all.
Thank you, madam. Other than the word thanks, I don't find anything else to convey my gratitude, madam. Thank you so much, madam. We would like to